Introduce Marty Allen Javors. I didn't know your middle name was Allen. And even though he's been around for a long time around the Health Science Center, in fact, he started here as did his postdoctoral fellowship here. You may not know that he got his degree in pharmacy from the University of Texas at Austin, and then got his PhD in pharmacy and pharmacology at the University of Colorado at Boulder. He's done a lot of different things, including he's a licensed pharmacist. He has a pharmacy license from the state of Texas, Board of Pharmacy. But in addition to that, and in addition to his faculty appointment in psychiatry and in pharmacology, he's also director of the Nathan Schock Center Bioanalytical Pharmacology Corps. And just recently, he became the leader of the pharmacology unit of the interventions testing program. So that's for all three of the sites that make up the intervention testing program. Part of that's because he has been involved with the intervention testing program since shortly after we started in 2004, and so he's really we never knew what to call him, just Marty, but he's really played a really big role in the making sure that we have very good pharmacology and all the studies in the intervention testing program. We developed the Bioanalytical Pharmacology Corps for the Nathan Schock Center so that we could export his knowledge, export the platform that he's built in pharmacology, and export it to a number of people around the country. And in fact, he's got something like 25 different people just in the last couple of years that have benefited from his services. So one other thing that you may not know about Marty is that he lists under community activities that he's director of the local golf qualifier for the U.S. Amateur Golf Championship. He's also co-founder and co-director of the San Antonio Open Golf Championship. And he's a member of the Regional Affairs Committee of the United States Golf Association. You might guess that he golfs from reading that. So with that, I'll let him get up here.
Okay. Thank you, Randy. This is a real pleasure for me to be involved with the aging group. Randy and I started talking about some of these things that I'll show you today, as he said, about 10 years ago, and it's really been one of the most exciting and thrilling parts of my career. I've known about the aging program here since I came here in 1979, but was never really involved with it till about 10 years ago. And there was sort of a confluence of events that led me to this place right now. One is I had a degree in pharmacy, and so I was familiar with pharmacy dosage forms and preparation of pharmacy dosage forms, and also some pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. And also, there used to be a part of pharmacy called pharmacognosy, which I took classes when I was in school. Did you have any pharmacognosy classes? So pharmacognosy is the study of naturally derived drugs. And it turns out that rapamycin is a naturally derived drug, which came from a yeast that was discovered, and it's used as an immunosuppressant in humans. But the aging study found a very important result with it, which I'll talk about ad nauseum in a few minutes. And so when Randy and I started talking, those background things that I knew were appropriate to what the problems that had to be solved, and you'll see today what I'm basically going to do is go through the chronology of those events and show you how we created a system that we use now for every single drug that wants to be, needs to be tested in the intervention testing program. I never did figure out how to forward the slides. Anybody? On where? There's no keyboard. Oh, maybe it's. There we go. All right, good. Okay, so to start off, this is our laboratory, part of our laboratory in the Department of Psychiatry. And these are the technical people that work in the lab. Jesse Sanchez has been working with me for about 15 years. Greg Friesenhahn, about 10 years. And Meredith Murrell just started working within the last 6 or 8 months. And the reason was to show pictures of them. But the other is to show these two machines here, which were purchased through funds from the Intervention Testing Program and the Barshop Institute. And these machines are mass spectrometers, and their importance can't really be understated. These machines, unlike UV detectors or electrochemical detectors, only measure what it is you ask them to measure. So if you know the chemical structure of the drug you have, you can tell that to the machine, its molecular weight, and that's what it'll draw into the machine from your sample and measurement. So what we have to try to do is be fast on our feet to develop new methods. Randy's group may call up on a Monday and they say, we want to test this new drug. Can you have a new assay for it in a couple of months? And so we have to go through the process of looking in the literature and then seeing what's there. If nothing's in the literature, we have to do it from scratch. But these mass specs enable you to almost eliminate the chromatography part of high-performance liquid chromatography. Usually, you identify a compound chromatographically by the time it elutes. And so you always have a strong possibility of interferences from the matrix in which the drug exists, like blood or saliva, urine, whatever. There may be things that'll be picked up by the ultraviolet detector or the electrochemical detector, which will interfere with your drug of interest. That is rarely a problem with mass spec. So these machines are have just taken us to a whole new place, really. So here's the challenge, just to kind of put things in perspective. Our job is to figure out an efficient, effective way to give a drug to a large number of research animals in aging studies. So as an example, the mouse aging studies, mice live 2 or 3 years, and you can't give them an injection every day. It would just wouldn't work. So you have to find a different way to treat them. The marmosets, for example, we decided to feed them the rapamycin drug in yogurt. So they had their own special way to get food. But for the mouse studies, it was decided before I got involved that the best way to dose them was in their lab chow. Typically, the lab chow is presented when the lights go off, and they have access to it all night long, and then it's taken away when the lights come on. So the process that we've decided and designed is that first we would create an assay to quantify the drug. That's what we want to do. We want to make sure it's in the food. We want to make sure it gets into the animal. We want to make sure it gets to the targeted site of action. So we do this with HPLC, with electrochemical detection and mass spec detection. And you can use ELISA methods also, but we typically use these because they're much more accurate and much more specific. And there are certain characteristics of each assay that have to be adhered to and determined in the process of developing this assay. And I would give some credit to Dr. Lamb, who's in the audience, for helping me learn about these things several years ago before I wanted to learn about them. And so once we've got the assay, we want to measure it in these various kinds of matrices. And then We also, as part of our challenge, we need to decide and characterize a dosage form to get the drug into the animal. In the case of rapamycin, it was lab chow. And so I'll explain the process of how we were able to make that work. And then make sure the drug gets into the animal. So we measure the drug in blood, brain, liver, heart, muscle. We've measured rapamycin in almost every tissue of the body, colon, stomach, not teeth. We haven't done it in teeth yet. So the general overall plan of figuring this out, I'm going over the same thing again, just so you get a feel for it, is the appropriate animal model must be decided upon. Mice were used for the rapamycin experiments, and now we're moving into other animals like the marmoset. It must decide how to administer the test agent. So a lot of drugs are given in drinking water, or I know in alcohol research studies, they use almost a chocolate milkshake for the animals to drink with alcohol in it. There are a number of different ways, but the lab chow was what was decided for the rapamycin experiments. We need to know the stability of the agent. When you put the drug into the lab chow and you have the lab chow sitting there on the counter for months and you're taking from it every day to feed them, is it stable? Does it stay the same concentration over time? And then we need to consider the therapeutic dose. How much of the drug do you have to give the animal to get the drug to the site of action and to expect a pharmacodynamic effect? So usually the investigator that brings the drug to us decides that, whether it's worked or not, but we let them know that the drug has reached the liver or the brain or whatever they're interested in. Sometimes we find these things in the literature, sometimes it's empirically, and sometimes the investigator that brings the drug to us will already know. Then we look at the pharmacokinetics. We usually don't have to do this very much because the animal starts eating when it gets dark, and then we take the blood levels right before take the food away, so what would be called more of a trough level, or we take the levels right before the food is represented to them, the next dark cycle. So when we look at trough cycles, that's our target to make sure they have enough drug. And then biochemical assays. In the case of rapamycin, mTOR activity was measured, the mechanistic target of rapamycin is the enzyme that rapamycin inhibits. So that's kind of the general overall picture. And here's the chronology of what happened with the rapamycin process. It had already been discovered that rapamycin extended the life cycle in a worm model. And so that was why it went on to further testing. That was reported in 2004. And so about that time is when the intervention testing program decided to test it in mice and design a really nice set of experiments using multiple doses of rapamycin. And that's about the time that Randy and I got involved talking with each other. And from our conversations, the first thing that we did was measure. Let me segue for a moment. At that time, I had a clinical laboratory where we were measuring psychotropic drugs to make sure that patients had enough drugs to expect a therapeutic effect for depression or schizophrenia or whatever. But I was always looking for ways to make money for the lab. And so there was a salesman for the pharmaceutical company that sold Rapamune, the rapamycin for humans. And he kept coming to me and saying, can you get an assay for rapamycin? We need to measure rapamycin. Nobody in the city measured it. and they needed it for immunosuppressive treatment of tissue replacements and things like that. And they needed to have it fall within a very distinct therapeutic range. And the doctors needed that feedback because it had side effects if it got too high. So I had developed the assay for rapamycin using HPLC with a UV detector, and I got the sensitivity down to about 3 nanogram per ml. And I measured it in about 25 samples from the hospital. They measured it elsewhere, and it correlated perfectly. So I was all ready to go and make all kinds of money. And they called me up and said, oh, we figured out a way to do it on our big machine. So I lost the business before I ever had it. But the good news is Randy came in, and we started talking about rapamycin. And I said, well, have you measured it in the blood? And so I had the assay. We measured in the blood, and the blood levels were way low. In fact, they were almost non-existent. So you can't expect a therapeutic effect or any kind of biochemical effect if you don't have the drug where it's going to cause its action.
You said you're using mass spec now, and I was wondering, is the big machine mass spec?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when you now have two of those, is it much better for doing the assay than how you originally designed the assay, or did it not change?
By far.
So it is much better.
The sensitivity is greater than tenfold. So we can measure tenfold lower doses or lower concentrations in whole blood. And, as I said before, you tell the machine to measure rapamycin. And that's all it measures. So you get beautifully clean chromatography. I don't have any pictures of that, but trust me, it's just clean as a whistle. And it comes out very quickly, too, in the system. So.
Oh, so you can do more.
Oh, yeah, we can do more samples, and we're much more accurate. And you'll see a lot of the data that we have. So that was the initial discovery. So then we measured it in food, and it was low in food. We measured it again in blood. And then Randy thought of the idea of microencapsulating rapamycin. We did that. We redesigned the lab chow preparation. We now got the proper levels in the lab chow. We got the proper levels in whole blood, and Randy did experiments to show that mTOR in adipose tissue was inhibited. So that's the whole scenario. Now I'll go through the steps one at a time and show you some of the data. So the first thing we did was create the assay, and by this time we had gotten the assay, we'd gotten our first mass spec, so we were able to develop a very nice assay with the HPLC mass spec in lab chow. We had a limit of detection of about 0.1 micrograms per gram in a 100 milligram sample. And we characterized the pellets by taking samples from all different parts of the pellets and from different pellets, and showed that there was very nice homogeneity. But the first measurements were intended to be at these concentrations in the chow pellets. And when we measured it, we found that the actual concentrations were significantly less, 23, 19, and 21%. That was done on January the 12th in 06. Right after the chow was made, as it sat around, even for less than a month, it went down. So we had two problems. One is we weren't getting enough in there. The other is it was dying while it was in there. So the idea came to me, well, let's check with who's making the lab chow and find out what's going on. So Purina was making the lab chow. And rapamycin, it turns out, is a very lipid-soluble chemical. It's kind of like pouring all oil in a cup of water. The oil stays in one part and the water goes in the other part. Well, the rapamycin stays in the oil part. So what they were doing was having a big vat. They were dumping chow powder in there, dumping water in there, and dumping powdered rapamycin in there, stirring it up, and then stamping pellets, which they dried at 95%, 95 degrees centigrade. So basically, number one, the rapamycin wasn't getting in there homogeneously. And number two, it was, for whatever reason, oxidation, I'm not sure, it was dying. It may have not even got into the pellets. It could have stayed separated and just not even got into them. We don't know the answer to that, but bottom line was it wasn't stable and there wasn't enough in there. So there were problems and the stability was not acceptable. And when you took those three concentrations of rapamycin pellets and they were given to the mice, you can see that what was intended to be 0.7 nanogram per milligram was 0.16, and we didn't see detectable levels in the blood, not even at the next highest dose. At the highest dose, which was supposed to be 42 nanogram per milligram, we saw blood levels, and this red bar here is the therapeutic range of rapamycin for humans for immunosuppressant effect, which we decided was our target range for the mice. And at the highest dose, some of these fell in, most of these fell into that range. So the beauty of the design, the original design, where they chose three doses of rapamycin, probably would have worked fine. But we decided and went back and saved money and became more accurate by improving the lab chow that was given. And this is the calibrator curve for whole blood. It turns out that 95% of rapamycin in blood is in the red blood cells, only 5% in the bathing plasma. So when you measure rapamycin in whole blood, you have to measure it in the red cells to be perfectly accurate. So we knew there was a problem with stability, and as I said, Randy dragged me along out to Southwest Research, and we talked to the people out there about microencapsulating rapamycin, trying to figure out some way to make it more stable. And this is a common way to do it. There is encapsulation, which is what we thought we were doing initially, but it's actually turned out to be entrapment, which is a little different distribution of the drug in the polymer. So the polymer that was decided upon was called Eudragit S100, and the drug molecules were suspended in the polymer matrix by a special spinning disk atomization process. Couldn't explain it to you, but it appears that because it was an anionic copolymer, that the interaction between rapamycin and the polymer was largely based as an ionic interaction. And it turns out that when this E-rapamycin or entrapped rapamycin goes into the body, it gets through the stomach, but the rapamycin separates from the polymer when the pH gets up to 7. And so as you go down the intestinal tract, the pH goes up. I think in the small intestine, it's around 4 to 5. And by the time it gets closer to the colon, terminal colon, it's up at 7 and above. So that's where it's absorbed. So now we had this entrapped rapamycin, and we went to see if it was more stable. And long story short is it was more stable. Once we got it going, this slide shows the process by which Southwest Research would make the E-rapamycin, send it to us. We would determine in our laboratory the true concentration of rapamycin in the E-rapamycin preparation. It was targeted to be 10% weight to weight. So you can see that the actual concentration varied over the time period from 2007 to 2011. So what we would do is, when we got the e-rapamycin and we determined the concentration, Elizabeth Fernandez, who works with Randy out at the bar shop, would calculate the amount of e-rapamycin powder that should be put in the lab chow. And they modified their preparation so that it would be homogeneous and more stable, and we did all those measurements, and it worked out just fine. So even today, we are using that same technique to create the food. And the animals eating that e-rapamycin chow ended up having the proper blood levels, which I'll show on the next slide. This slide, I won't really go through the details, but it just shows the calculations that we would go through. And the one assumption I wanted to mention to you that is used in all of these calculations is how much a mouse eats in a day. And so David Harrison, was it David or Rich?
Rich
Miller actually measured the amount of pellet weight that mice ate every day, and it was around 4 to 5 grams per day. So that is one of the variables that we have to accept. We can't tell the mouse, like your mother told you, eat everything on your plate. They're going to eat what they want to eat, and then they'll stop. So that's one of the variables. The different mouse strains eat different amounts, and males and females eat different amounts. But we used the 5 gram. We assumed that all of the animals ate 5 grams of chow every day. And that's how we did our calculations to determine what dose the animals would get and what concentration of rapamycin should be in the lab chow. And then we measured the rapamycin in the e-rapamycin lab chow and determined, this was the very first one we did. It didn't get quite up to 7 where we hoped it would be in this first measurement, but this is a slide from back around 2006. And subsequent levels are always up around 6 to 7 parts per million, which is what was targeted. And then the blood levels that we measured, this is just rapamycin powder put in the food. This is the microencapsulated rapamycin. And if you'll notice, these levels that were achieved in the mice were between the 3 to 30 therapeutic range that we targeted. So now we felt like we were online to get a good, clear answer to the hypothesis that whether or not rapamycin would affect the aging process. And I won't say much about the pharmacokinetics because we don't do much of this, but rapamycin has a different half-life. Typically, a drug will have the longest half-life in humans, and then as you go down the evolutionary species list, the half-lives will become significantly shorter. But even in the mouse, we calculated it to be approximately 12 hours. So we felt confident that just giving the mice once a day dosing would work. If it had been a shorter half-life, we'd have probably had to go to higher doses, higher concentrations in the food to make sure that we had enough in the tissue to inhibit mTOR during the entire time. And then this is the pharmacodynamic effect. So we did not do these experiments. Randy did these experiments. And basically they show that in the control food in males, there was very little inhibition of mTOR. But in the rapamycin fed, there was very good inhibition, both in males and females. So that completed the cycle. We've got it in the food, we've got it in the blood, we've got it at the site of action. And since we came up with this process, I think I have somewhere around 4,500 data points for rapamycin levels in whole blood. We've had people literally from all over the country and from here send us samples, and we've measured, and they get food from the intervention testing program out at the bar shop. Randy has a process out there where they send the food out, and people give it to their animals, and then we measure the blood levels to make sure that the animals have enough. So these are just some of the people that used it and the blood levels that they got in their animals. So three up to 30 is where we were targeting. And you can see there's quite a bit of variability. But the idea was to get up in the therapeutic range and then have confidence that it was having its effect. And you'll see the success rate shortly when I show you all the studies that have been published. And this slide I just kind of threw in as a bonus. Sometimes you want to measure a drug in a little critter like a mouse on several occasions, even like for pharmacokinetic studies or a few days in a row. So we now have a procedure where we can take about 50 microliters of blood from a mouse tail and spot it on these clinical dried spot cards. These are used in clinical analytical studies a lot. And we showed that basically what this slide showed is that the blood, if you drop it on there without pressing it on, it is homogeneous across the entire spot. And you can tell that by the color of it, but we actually did an experiment to show that it was true. And then when we measured rapamycin with our whole blood assay and our spot test assay on the exact same samples, we got a very nice correlation for looks like about 10 samples. So that's something that we have available for future studies if it's needed. Okay, so after that whole process, this initial publication was published in Nature in 2009. And figure three kind of shows all the results. The blood levels that were achieved were out of what the therapeutic range is in human, but were definitely enough to inhibit the mTOR. And Randy's experiments showed that the mTOR was inhibited, and this shows the same thing. And the bottom line is up here in these two graphs that showed that when mice, C57 black 6 mice, were started to be treated with rapamycin at 270 days, so almost a year old, that the group with rapamycin in both the males and the females lived significantly longer. And that really caused a big splash. It was a very well-received discovery. And this is a graph showing the number of publications when I searched on PubMed for rapamycin and aging. And here is where the paper was published in Nature. So you can see that the interest in studying rapamycin and its various effects on cancer or kidney disease or any other muscle disease, immune disease, are expanding at a pretty rapid clip. So that was the first finding. And this article, this research finding, was listed as one of the top findings of 2009 in Science Magazine, which is a real nice tribute to the people in the intervention testing program. Rich Miller at University of Michigan, David Harrison at Jackson Labs, and Randy Strong here. I forget what won it. Do you remember what won it, Randy?
No, I don't remember.
I meant to look it up, but I didn't. But there were 10 others that were mentioned, and the rapamycin finding was one of them. And since about 2011, these are a list, partial list of publications that have been funded by people in the intervention testing program or people at our university. So, and they show effects of rapamycin in all different kinds of mouse strains. They compare it to, it's been compared to other drugs in genetically heterogeneous mice. The relationship to some of these stress compounds, different mice, effects on memory, nitric oxide synthase, Alzheimer's models. So there have just been a number of studies in a number of different areas. It's really quite impressive to me. And as part of the same intervention testing program, this is a partial list. Right now, there's somewhere between 15 and 20 drugs that have been tested extensively that we've created an analytical method for, measured it in the blood, helped with experimental design to make sure the animals were getting the drug. And this is a list of investigators for which we've made measurements. They've sent us samples, and we've measured ICAR in plasma, doxorubicin in blood and tissue, rapamycin in blood, rapamycin in skin, blood in human skin and blood, a compound TAC-242, more rapamycin in human blood. This was a nice cancer study looking at the effect on the bladder cancer. And here's the Marmoset study where we validated the levels of rapamycin in yogurt and then in the blood of the marmosets. And then people nationally from all different institutes have sent in samples and have published papers and submitted grants based on the stuff that they got from us, the levels. So that's the short and sweet version. And there are many people to thank. The productivity and the capability of my lab has been dramatically expanded by my involvement with the aging program and the funding that's been received through the intervention testing program, the Nathan Schock Center, the Barshop Institute, and then my coworkers in the bioanalytical pharmacology corps in the Department of Psychiatry. It's been really a wonderful collaboration, and I think we just got refunded for the intervention testing program, and same thing should happen with the Nathan Schock Center. Hopefully next fall we'll get refunded again. And then the Pepper Center, we may be involved with that also, but not exactly sure how, but that's in for review now. So I think I talked fast and finished kind of quick, but that's it. Thank you. Any questions, comments?
Is there any difficulty depending on the tissue that you are measuring the rapamycin? Like, do you have like measuring in the heart versus the lungs or the skin or the blood?
Are there problems, you say?
Yeah.
Not really. The procedure we've developed is quite simple. Rapamycin is very lipid-soluble. There's a term called lipid-water partition coefficient, where you take a test tube and you have water in the bottom and hexane or heptane or something in the top. You put the drug in and you see its distribution. Well, rapamycin, I don't know exactly what it is, but it's 10 or 20 to 1 in the lipid nonpolar layer. So typically what we'll do is we'll weigh out, this is what we try first every time, and it almost always works. We'll ask for 100 milligrams of tissue, skin, heart, liver, lung, whatever, and we will homogenize it with either sonication or a grinder and completely homogenize the tissue using methanol or acetonitrile. And then we centrifuge it down, and the tissue all precipitates all the protein, everything goes to the bottom. And we'll take the supernatant, run it through a filter just to get rid of junk, and then either inject it directly onto the HPLC system or dry it down to residue and bring it back up in a small volume of mobile phase and inject it into the system.
How can you be sure when you're measuring the tissue that you are not measuring the rapamycin that is associated with the blood in that tissue?
That's a good question. Typically, the tissues that we get have been rinsed by the people that send them, and there really is not a significant amount of blood in there. I would think the percent of blood in the tissue is negligible. The amount of rapamycin in the blood is negligible to what's in the tissue. Now, having said that, the levels in the tissue are usually much lower in some instances and sometimes almost as much as in the blood. It depends on the tissue and how well it takes up the drug. So in the brain, you might expect a lot higher because it's more lipid in the brain. But other tissues, like muscle, maybe not so much.
Anybody from the park have a question? Oops. Anybody from the park have a question?
She said no.
That was a no. I'll take it that's a no. Okay.
Oh, can I?
Yeah, go ahead.
So you made a nice long list, and you started with humans, and now you're doing a whole bunch of different species. Do you find or feel, I don't know, or the data or your opinion, that these are very, that the metabolites are very different? You mentioned the rates of metabolism are different, but do you think they turn them into different very much?
The rapamycin is not extensively metabolized. The metabolites are probably less than 10% concentration of the parent drug. There's been studies that have been done on that, not in every tissue or every animal, but the ones that I've seen, there's very little metabolism.
And that makes it different from other drugs then?
Well, we just started doing a project with a drug called idebenone. And idebenone has a half-life of about 4 minutes or something. And it's glucuronidated at first pass through the liver, almost 100%. So some drugs get metabolized very quickly, and others don't. Rapamycin does not. As I showed the PK curve in the mice. Yeah, it is long.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yeah, it's even longer in humans. That's, yeah. You know, some drugs you take 4 times a day, some you take once a day. And the goal is to achieve a blood level in the trough that produces the therapeutic effect and minimizes the side effects. And so in humans, that's the goal. And that's basically, in our experiments, we don't want the levels to get up so high to harm the animals, but at its lowest level, we want to make sure it's inhibiting the enzyme or blocking uptake or whatever the pharmacodynamic endpoint is.
So if there are no more questions, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.